Hey guys, it is Steve Kummer. It is Coronagate day 108. And before I kind of get into reading Psalm 19 to you and kind of looking at Psalm 19, what I'm going to do is just going to give you a little bit of an update about what happened in the leadership team meeting tonight. If you are awake, in fact, I'm going to move my phone over slightly so I can see you guys. If you are here, make sure you say hello. Stick any comments you want to do in the comment section below. Also, can you tell me if you can hear me okay? Because I did have some audio issues earlier. So we met as a leadership team yesterday, and there's a couple of things that kind of came out from the leadership team meeting. As you guys know, from the 4th of July, the church can start meeting together again publicly. And we discussed what we were going to do in regards to the new kind of government restrictions. And I'm going to tell you what we decided to do. Obviously, all of this stuff, like everything that's going on in the world right now, is subject to change. You can hear me. Hallelujah. There were some massive audio issues earlier, or I would have been with you earlier. So we've decided what we're going to do is sometime around mid-July, maybe even the end of July, we're going to trial a public service. That's going to be on a Friday night, and it's going to be Eden 2.0. So we're going to start there. Our philosophy is going to be slow and in stages. Slow and in stages. So we're going to have kind of like a group that meets on the Friday night. We will also live stream that group. We're looking at what kind of PPE we need to get, what kind of broadcast stuff that we need to get. That group will not be more than 30 people. Sunday will continue online as before. The next stage is we will start to gather together a small group on the Sunday morning. Again, we will live stream, so it will be kind of like a hybrid service. So the church will probably be put into three distinct streams. Our leader stream, Josh will lead a stream, and Jamie will lead a stream. And those streams will kind of gather together around hubs. So those hubs will be around the kind of marsh, Church on the Marsh kind of plant, the Eden 2.0 and HQ1, which is Hope Church. We are only planning, at least at the moment, with the government restrictions that are upon us, we're only planning of having groups of 30 or under in the church at that time. The other thing we are going to be doing is we're going to be revamping our online. So the next few weeks, you're going to be seeing a revamp of our online. Coronagate vlogs will come to an end on Saturday, the 4th of July, but we are going to be doing Hope daily vlogs. The Coronagate vlog on the Sunday morning will disappear entirely. And on the Saturday, we're going to be doing more of a kind of interview style thing. We still might call it Breakfast at Timothy's. And what Tim Morris is going to be doing, he's going to be talking to people within the church. He's going to be hearing their stories. It's going to be not just based around the testimony. It's going to be kind of like an archive. Tell us what it was like growing up, where you grew up. You know, tell us what your favorite books are. Tell us what your hopes and fears are for the future. Tell us who your heroes are, etc., etc. And then we'll do that over coffee and breakfast and all those kinds of things. And it's just a way of people being able to tell their story. And we're obviously ramping up to Hope 40, which will be next year when the church, Lancaster Free Methodist Church and Hope Church, will be celebrating their 40th birthday. But then in 10 years' time, we're hoping to do a time capsule. So in 10 years' time, we can use some of that material. But also, it's going to be good for your friends and your family to hear a little bit about your story. And it's going to be great for us outreach-wise because people get introduced to hopesters, which come from all different walks of life and have had all different experiences. We also want to give a great big shout out and a big thank you to Chrissy Hetrick. Chrissy Hetrick has been the admin for the church for a year. She's going to be having a baby. That post probably won't exist in 12 months' time. We don't know. We're still kind of looking at how it's all going to all fit together. But we just wanted to give you a great big shout out. We hope you enjoy the flowers. There's flowers coming later, and there's another little thing that we've got. We just want to say we are for you and we are with you. And I guess the other thing that I just want to add in the midst of everything before we get into the text is our focus has to be on health and growth. So how are we going to be healthy? A church that serves our local community, a church that takes the Bible seriously, a church that believes in holiness, a church that believes in social justice, a church that is exploring more and more the gifts of the Spirit and the working of the Spirit. And how might we be a church that grows? We want to see people saved. We want to see people people's lives transformed. And the way in which we're going to try and do that is through a hybrid of actual church and virtual church. So some of you guys might have questions. Feel free to ask any questions. You can stick them in the comments section, and or you can speak to me, Jamie, or Josh. But we are in the midst of trying to work out all of this stuff as we speak. And on Monday, when we have our leaders Zoom, we're going to be trying to figure out the kind of practical realities of what online will look like and the practical realities of what church will look like. So watch this space. And that is the kind of gist and the basic stuff that came from the leadership team meeting. So let me read Psalm 19 to you. And then let me just kind of share some thoughts or ideas of how this psalm has been speaking to me. So if you've got your Bible, feel free to join us, but I will read the passage too. And it is an absolutely awesome psalm. I think this psalm was Martin Luther, the Protestant reformer. This psalm was Martin Luther's favorite psalm. Here's what it says. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the skies proclaim the works of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth. Their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun. It is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuits to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey, than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them there is great reward. Who can discern their own errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sin. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless, innocent of great transgression. And may these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. So the psalm kind of splits itself into kind of three very easy kind of sections. The first section deals with general revelation. It deals with God communicating through nature. The second section deals with what's called special revelation, how God communicates through scripture. And the third part is to do with a kind of like a subjective or personal understanding of God and hearing his voice. And it deals with character. So nature, scripture, character is the way in which I saw this psalm split up. Also, I think I kind of stole that. You know, when you listen to loads of sermons and you read loads of books, you often think that you've come up with this great way of parsing the psalms or chopping up the psalms, only to find that you've probably heard somebody else say it. So there is no copyright in the kingdom of God. So we hear God through nature. You know, the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. The skies proclaim the work of his hand. There is David. He is the king upon a throne. He is the richest man in Israel. He is the most powerful man in Israel. And although he could talk about the way in which he could hear God's voice or see God's creativity or his goodness in architecture or riches or the beauty of his harem. So David had multiple wives. Not that we're saying that this is a good thing, but he did. He's saying, no, it's when I go outside, when I'm in the Lake District, when I look up at the sky and the sky is ablaze with the glory of the Lord through the stars and through the sun. Stick in the comment section if you want to, guys, as well. How do you hear God through creation? I love, this makes me sound like a real hippie. I love the sound of water. I love the sound of rain. I love the sound of birdsong. I love looking at the skies. I love looking at the intricate detail of things like leaves and I don't know if any of you are parents or grandparents. Like when you've got your little kids and just how they are so intricately knitted together, you see something of the awesomeness of the design of God. Now I know that we often feel intimidated by science and scientists and we feel that we are always on the back foot and we have to try to kind of explain away that God is the creator. But when we look at creation, I think we know, hey, whoever is logged in on the Hope Church account, when we look at creation, we can see that there is a creator. You know, there is a Picasso who has painted the sky. Do you know what I mean? There is a kind of a Beethoven who has brought together the beauty of the sounds of nature. And I don't think that we should be intimidated or we should be on the back foot when it comes to science and spirituality or the Bible and science. I don't think we should worship creation. I do think the radical environmental kind of movement and some religions, kind of like Hinduism, and I say that respectfully, I've got family members from those kind of backgrounds, see God and creation as one. That's not what I'm talking about. He is the creator. He's deserving of all our worship. Creation is not deserving of our worship. But from creation, whether it's God-made or man-made, we can see something of the attributes of God. Then we look at God's revelation through scripture. You know, I've got some presuppositions as an evangelical. I believe the Bible is the word of God. The reason why when I preach on a Sunday morning or even when I'm doing kind of vlogs like this or when it comes to kind of my worldview, it is always subservient to the scripture. Because in the scripture, we hear God's voice. We hear his direction. We hear his commands. And I think within scripture, yes, maybe there are some complexities, but the main things are the plain things. And God speaks through his scripture. And when he talks about this scripture, he's not like, oh, this is so boring. Oh, this is so boring. This is so dull. He's like, the law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making the wise simple. He's like, when my soul feels weary, like when I feel down, I take my Rocky Balboa scriptures and I stick my chest out and I stick my head up and I'm like this, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. He shall never leave me, nor shall he forsake me. You know, I meditate upon the fact that for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that whoever should believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. You know, I think of the fact that he takes my sin, he separates them as far as the east is from the west, that he puts them behind his back, he remembers them no more. The fact that I'm a new creation in Christ, old things have passed away, and it refreshes my soul. It refreshes my soul, it brings strength to my very being. It helps me and it holds me and it keeps me. And you know, David sees this. David, he has advisors around him in the court. You know, he gets to mix with the intelligentsia of Israel. But even in the midst of all that, he's like, no way. It's amen. You go, Steve. Thank you. I feel like preaching, man, because I'm standing up. You know, it's the law of God that's perfect. It makes the simple wise. My parents never went to university. People I grew up with never went to university. You know, I got chucked out of school, but it was through the word of God. I mean, I eventually did get my degree in a postgraduate, but it was through the word of God transforming my mind that I, as a simple, uneducated, guy, you know, I began to kind of develop and grow, not just spiritually and emotionally and within my character, but also intellectually. Like the fear of the Lord is the beginning of all knowledge. And that's not just in the spiritual things, you know, it shapes our world view. And then the final thing is he talks about this kind of subjective or personal revelation, and that's seen in character. He's like, he says here, who can discern their own errors? But he's like, Lord, forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sin. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless, innocent of great transgression. May these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. He's like, Lord, I give to you my life. I do not want to err into sin. I do not want to err into transgression. Lord, I want the meditations of my heart, you know, my secret life, my inner life. I want the meditations of my heart to be acceptable within your sight. And here we see that when David is confronted with God's revelation in nature, and when David is confronted with God's revelation in scripture, it makes him look inward, but not in like a self-absorbed, navel-gazing way. He's like, look, because you are so awesome, because you are so brilliant, what I want to do is I want to live in a way that is honoring to you, not because of law, not because I feel compelled to, but because I want to. This comes from grace, and this comes from love. So that's the difference between holiness and legalism. Holiness is based on grace and love, and legalism is all based upon laws. It's very easy within the Christian life to get caught up into legalism. But let me just remind you once again, just in case you need to be reminded, Jesus Christ loves you, he is for you, and that is why you need to live a Christ-honoring life. Not because by doing all of these Christ-honoring things that you can score brownie points for the afterlife, but because he loves you and he gave himself for you. So guys, hopefully that's encouragement for your soul, and it's kind of lifted you. It's blinking lifted me, and it's just great to be with you. We're going to give you more information of how we kind of move forward as we exit lockdown. But as I said before, it's very slow, it's cautious, it's tentative. Everything could change again. So I'm going to pray for you, and I'm going to let you get on with the rest of your day. Father, we thank you that you are a God who speaks, that you are not a God who is silent. And I just want to pray for everybody who has been watching or will be watching later. Lord, I pray that you would speak to them in a very clear way through nature. I pray that you would speak through scripture. And Lord, I pray that there would be a revelation for them personally, and it would affect their character. I pray these things for Jesus Christ's sake, and all God's people say or type amen. Here's a comment. Yes, thank you, God, for everything you have done in my life, everything that you will do in my life. A great start to the day, Steve. Thank you. Guys, flipping love ya. Go out there, take today by the scruff of the neck, and live awesome for Jesus. Okay, I better go, guys. I'll see you in a bit.